In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, amen. Good morning, everyone. Hopefully everybody's enjoying some nice warmth and probably touch 80 degrees and sunny today. So hopefully we get a chance to spend it outdoors as well. So in this Lent, we are living differently at St. Paul's. Every week, we want a different perspective that's going to make this Lent, that's going to make our lives differently. And those are all the different things that we've talked about from pre-Lent Sunday. We talked about the first one being pretense. Actually, no more pretense. No more pretending. No more pretending. We want to be real this Lent. No fake stuff. No fake fasting. No fake prayer. No fake giving, right? So we want to be authentic with all our heart. The second week, we talked about the prize. We wanted the prize to be God first. And not a life of worry, not a life of having two masters, but God first in my life. The third week, we said, don't worry. Not only not worry, and don't think that everything's going to go great, because I'm going to take my mask off, I'm going to live like God is first, and everything's going to go great. Absolutely not, because Lent is a time of probation, a time of testing, whether it's by temptations or by trials, and we talked about how to deal with those situations. Then we talked about, in this, we're going to live differently in being prodigal, and be careful in terms of maybe wasting our time, maybe our money, our resources in negative things, but be wasteful in a positive things, like that woman who was basically poured the alabaster flask and poured her love. So wasteful in a good sense, but not wasteful in a wrong sense. And last week, we talked about a whole bunch of things that you probably never knew about perfume. But we said that though God does not have a nose, there's certain things that smell amazing, amazing to God. And that's love, obedience, and sacrifice. When we talked about both St. Mary last week, because it was the Feast of Annunciation, and even the Samaritan woman, as it was Samaritan Woman Sunday. This week we're going to live differently, being penitent. Being penitent. And this is coming from verse 14 in John chapter 5 today, when Jesus said something really, really strange. So again, the story, we probably, for those who've been coming to church for a long time, know that the story that we pray on the fifth week of Sunday is that Jesus hears this paralytic, who was very actually persistent. And though he was not able, all he had to do is go to this water, and when he steps in first, and then the angel stirs it, he would be healed. And he went there for 38 years, hoping and praying that somebody would help him. So Jesus actually said, you don't need the angel, I'm here. And of course he healed them, and he was able to walk. But then he said something strange, like we don't get it. He said, go and sin no more. And actually he even said something worse. He said, lest a worse thing happen to you. Go and sin no more. It's like, I'm a paralyzed guy waiting for an angel to come. What does sin have to do with it? St. John Chrysostom says the following. Here we learn in the first place that his disease, not everybody's, but his disease was the consequence of sins. So that's why Jesus, knowing the heart. Next week, we're going to read a different story. It's about the man that's born blind, right? And the disciples said, like, who screwed up? Who screwed up? What did this guy do? Or what did its parents do? I said, no, none. So next week, it's the opposite. But this week, according to certain fathers, we'll just read two of them, that his disease was a consequence of sins. Do all diseases proceed from sin? Not all, but most. Interesting, most. Some proceed from different kinds of loose living, since gluttony, intemperance, and sloth produce similar sufferings. So a lot of our diseases, and you think about it, you know, health-wise, could be because of sin. Maybe gluttony, it could lead me to diabetes or heart disease. So we don't obviously point to say you must be a glutton because you have diabetes or whatever. Obviously, I'm going there, but I'm saying we can understand that certain diseases can lead, or certain sins can lead to sicknesses. St. Theophylact said the same thing. By the Lord's words to the paralytic, behold, thou art made whole, sin no more. We learn first of all that illness in man stems from sin. So sin no more. So how are we going to live differently? We're going to be a penitent. So So as according to dictionary.com, it's one sentence, but I divide it into three bullets. You'll see why. But penitent basically is somebody feeling or expressing sorrow for sin or wrongdoing, disposed to atonement and amendment, repentant and contrite. This is just one word. This is, sorry, one sentence that was mentioned. But we want to divide it into three because we want to take a look at it as, how am I going to live differently as a repentant? How do I live differently as a repentant? Well, let's take the three and talk about them. The first one is sorrow, right? Expressing sorrow for sin. Like feeling sad. There has to be if I hurt a brother, if I committed a sin of impurity, like there needs to be a feeling of, if the Holy Spirit is working inside me, some kind of sorrow, some kind of grief. However, be careful, because not all sorrow is actually good. Not all sorrow is godly. St. Paul says, godly sorrow produces repentance, leading to salvation not to be regretted. But the sorrow of the world produces death. It's completely different. One way of being sorrow, one way of being grieving, can lead to repentance and salvation, but another one will lead it to death. How? How? We'll see in a second. Depends what you're sorry for. Like if you're so sorry, like I'm so, I, you know, like if your sorrow is, man, I can't believe I got caught. I can't believe I got, like really, like everything was going great and they had to like catch me at work, you know, whatever, goofing off. Or my expense report. Or my, you know, maybe I did something that's not ethical. And you're not sorry because you did something not ethical. You got sorry, you got caught. That's not godly sorrow. Or maybe more common, we say this phrase, I can't believe I did that. I can't believe I did that. You know how many confessions start off with, Father James, I can't believe I did that. This may sound like something that's maybe humbling, but it's actually a little bit of pride. A little bit of pride. Because why can't you believe it? You're human. You're going to fall. So I can't believe I, you know, said those words. I can't believe I did that act. I can't believe I looked at those scenes. I can't believe it. This is not godly sorrow. This is not godly. This is a little bit of pride. This is saying, are you over, like, any type of sin? We just read of saints, like, all these saints are falling into so many different things. Are we above the saints that we're not going to fall? So we want genuine sorrow or sadness. There's a nice little chart that had a little comparison between godly sorrow and worldly sorrow. See, godly sorrow brings change. Godly sorrow brings change. That's the difference. Godly sorrow produces repentance. I have sorrow. I want to do something about it. Worldly sorrow leads to just leaving, staying where you are and staying in your grief. I'm so bad. I don't deserve to stand before the presence of God. I can't go to church. I'm so bad. Refuses change. Godly sorrow sees sin as a crime against God or something I have sinned, like as we say in Psalm 50, I have sinned against you. Against you only have I sinned. Like this is between me and God. As opposed to the person who's sorry that he got caught. Doesn't care about what God thinks. He just cares that he got caught or she got caught. Worldly sorrow seeks to excuse sin and judges. Just a whole bunch of excuses. Godly sorrow is God-focused. Again, I sinned against you. I want to restore my relationship with you. Worldly sorrow is self. I got caught. I can't believe I did that. I. So hopefully we have the distinction between godly sorrow, which actually produces repentance, and then leads to salvation, as opposed to worldly sorrow, which may lead to despair, or may lead to death because you're not changing. So the first step, according to our blessed and wise dictionary.com, is sorrow is the first step. Second, there's a second. Because we can't just stay in godly sorrow, even though it's the right first step. Amendment. There needs to be a change. And it needs to have something that happens after that point. Jeremiah says in Jeremiah 7:3, amend your ways and your deeds, and then I will dwell in your place. Like, God needs to see change. I will dwell in your place. I will come. But change. Change whatever. Jesus gives us a very, 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 very practical example, okay, of amending something. He said the following. He said, look, if you bring your gift to the altar, so everybody coming to church used to come, like if we come to church, we bring. Now it's online and whatever. But imagine like before, everybody would bring something as they come to their Sunday worship. If you bring your gift to the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift before the altar. Go your way, first be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. Make a change. Oh, but I feel really bad. I hurt my brother. Great. Oh, I shouldn't have said those words. Great. Godly sorrow. Make amendment. Did you go apologize? Did you go try to reconcile? Actually, Jesus says this is the only excuse. If we want one excuse only for skipping church, there's only one valid excuse, in that you chose to reconcile with your brethren rather than coming here. Other than that, it's just not a valid excuse. Go and make a change. But leave your gift, right? If you come to church and you're like, you are the one that brought the coffee, make sure you leave the coffee here. Okay, leave the coffee here, the bagel's here. Leave the kit. That's what he said. Leave your gift before the altar. Leave whatever. If you brought food, you brought the wine for the, leave it here. Go fix it. Come back. Come back. Make a change. Don't stay at just godly sorrow. I really do feel bad. Great. I shouldn't have done that. Great. I fall at the mercy of God. Great. That's only the first step. Second step is make a change. Jesus, being very practical, gives us an example. The third and final step is to repent. See, make a change is one action. That's great. You made a change. You went to your brother and you apologized. I stole something, right? This is not every sin we can make amends. Not every, right? I mean, some things are like too late. But like, for example, stealing, if you stole something, we can give it back. So it's great that you feel bad, but make amends. Make an amendment, change. And we have to give back if we have stolen something. These are one-shot, like one-time actions. Repentance now starts in here. Now becomes me. I did a godly sorrow. I did make amends. I fixed my problem. Repentance now says fix you. Fix you. And this is always a step, right? When Peter gave his famous sermon in Acts chapter 2, and they all said, what can I do? What can I do? Like Peter preaches to everybody, and he says, well, what do we do next? The first words out of his mouth, of course they have to be baptized. But he says, no, repent first, and then be baptized. And that's what we still do to this day. When people come to the church, well, we got to repent. You got to, like, let's say you weren't worshiping God or you're worshiping God differently. No, you got to change. You got to repent. And you got to confess. And then, of course, then we baptize them. So we do the same thing now as what was done back then. And sometimes we think of repentance as a sad act. It's the furthest from the truth. And this is one of my favorite verses. It says, repent, therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, so that times of refreshing. Refreshing, right? If you're going to be outside today in 80-degree weather, maybe you're going to go for a run, you're going to come out pretty sweaty. Nothing's better than a nice shower after that. Refreshing. Refreshing. That's repentance. It's the shower after the sweaty, disgusting smell that we needed last week's perfume for. That's refreshing. That's repentance. And this is what God wants from us, always. I have no pleasure. This is God speaking. I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked. But the wicked turn from from their way and live. So repentance is now me. It's here. It's like, you know what? I don't want to hurt my brother. I don't want to keep causing friction. Now, what do I have to do? How do I renew my mind? I don't want to continue to be a person who has no self-control, right? I don't want to be a person who can't control their belly. I don't want to be that person. Although I could have sorrow and I may make amendments, now I want to renew my mind, as St. Paul says, because transformation begins with the renewing of your mind. Proverbs says, so as he thinks, so is he. As he thinks, so is he. So careful. Don't call yourself, I'm just an angry person. I'm just a lustful person. I'm just a selfish person. I'm just, and you fill in the blank. Okay? If that's who you are. If that's who you say you are. As he thinks. So as he thinks in his heart, so is he. Sure. Or I'm a repentant person. I'm a person that, yes, struggles with anger, but I can overcome this with the grace of God. For as he thinks in his heart, so is he. So is he. Fill ourselves with positives. That's why St. Paul says in Philippians 4:8, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue, is there anything praiseworthy, meditate, fill my mind, renew your mind. I'm struggling with impurity, fill it with purity. I'm struggling with jealousy, fill it with gratefulness. Fill it, fill your mind. Fill your mind, meditate on these things. Meditate on the positives. See the difference between amendment and repentance. But it goes through those progression. I want to be a penitent person today. I want to be a penitent person, and I want to live differently this Lent. This Lent, I am penitent. I will have godly sorrow, not worldly sorrow, which leads me to despair and to death, actually. But godly sorrow with godly grief, convicted that this is actually wrong. I feel bad. But then I want to make amends. I got to make a change. And then I want to work on my mind so that I don't have to be this person who struggles. I'm going to be a new person, transformed by the renewing of my mind. And glory be to God forever. Amen.